Korteyten. طيب، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We still in the introduction of this book, which is the book of the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as we said, it's very important for the Muslim. The first thing that he should know is what? Aqeed. Especially at this time. The problem, deviation of aqeedah is real problem, because that means may take man out of Islam while he thinks that he is still in the straight path. Matter of aqeedah is very important. This is what we should care, and this is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he spent most of the da'wah time for the aqeedah. 13 years of the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Mecca, just to what? Huh? To put the foundation of the aqeedah and the belief in Allah Azza wa Jal. طيب. طيب. We talked last week, the last thing that we talked about is that Allah Azza wa Jal subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, and this would, should be our belief, that all types of sins could be forgiven. That means even the person, he died and he didn't repent from these sins, there is hope that Allah Azza wa Jal may forgive him, or maybe he punished for some time, but he will not abide in the hell forever, except one sin, which is shirk. Shirk, this is a sin that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never forgive if a man die in the state of shirk or kufr. But if he repented before he died, even a matter of few minutes even before he died, he uttered the shahada sincerely from his heart, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive him, because this is what Allah Azza wa Jal said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءَ. طيب. And we mention many different hadith which show you the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. طيب, it is reported that Utban ibn Malik stated, the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Allah has forbidden for fire all those who say La ilaha illallah, seeking thereby the face of Allah. Naam? Look at this hadith. Forbidden. That means fire will not touch them. Those who say what? La ilaha illallah. But what? Huh? Look at the end of the, huh? Seeking the face of Allah Azza wa Jalla. That means they are said out of what? Of sincerity. They are sincere when they say this. And just not by, just a word by them. Right. It is also reported from Jabir that the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, whoever die not associating anything with Allah will enter paradise. Will enter paradise. Anyone who die in the state of Tawheed, believing in the oneness of Allah Azza wa Jal, according to this hadith, will enter al-Jannah. طيب. And this hadith was mentioned in Muslim, and Sahih Muslim. And the hadith about intercession, al-Shafa'a. You know this al-Shafa'a. It is reported that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, by my glory, my majesty, my bride, and my might, I will bring forth from the hell those who say La ilaha illallah. This hadith also reported where? In al-Bukhari. So it is authentic hadith. So anyone who die in the state of Tawheed, he will end in Jannah. But here this hadith, what does it say? Will bring forth from where? Huh? That means there are some people هو التوحيد, they may be what? Be punished. And they will be touched by the hell. But the end, they will be moved to where? To Jannah. This is very, very important. So those who die while they are committing major sin, there are three states. Either they ask forgiveness and Allah forgives them. Either that Allah Azza wa Jalla out of His mercy will forgive them, because He is the one who has the command and He do whatever He want and He is very merciful. Or He will be punished and then will enter paradise. This punishment, my dear brothers, it's come in different ways also. Either through calamity, problems, hardship that meet the person during his lifetime. And there's hadith which, you know, confirmed this, said, لا يزال البلاء بالمؤمن حتى يخرج من الدنيا وليس عليه خطيئة, أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. طيب, trial still going on the believer till he come or get out of this dunya without any sin. All this and other hadith that the meaning that even the thorn that touch or even very small tiny injury touch the believer in this world, Allah Azza wa Jal to clear his sins. So this is mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, my dear brothers, if the Muslim was touched in this world of any calamity, any problems, either social, financial, health, whatever, he should be what? Be patient and thank Allah Azza wa Jal. And believe that Allah Azza wa Jal intend good this world for him. طيب. It is reported from Abu Sa'id al-Khudri that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, the people of paradise will enter paradise and the people of hell will enter hell. Then Allah will say, bring forth everyone in whose heart was faith, the weight of grain of mustard seed. Even tiny. That means the origin of Tawheed is where? In his heart. So this is to show you the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. Abu Sufyan said, I lived near Jabir ibn Abdullah in Mecca for 6 months. A man asked him, do you call any of the people of the Qibla kafir? You see this expression, Ahlul Qibla. Ahl al-Qibla. People of the Qibla. What does it mean? Those who face the Qibla. This general word, that's mean anyone who face the Qibla in his prayer. So you ask him, do you call anyone who face the Qibla as a kafir? Look to this Sahabi, what he said. Abdullah ibn Jabir al-Sahaba, radhiyallahu anhu, he said, no. Therefore, we cannot label any Muslim who face the Qibla, who pray, who believe in Allah Azza wa Jal as kafir. Right. These texts, so this here, the conclusion of the Sheikh here. These texts led prominent scholars among the Salaf of this Ummah to say, of the one who commits sins and neglect obligatory duties, he is a believer, even he committing sin, even he sometimes, you know, neglect some duties, but we cannot get him out of the fold of Islam. This is very important, especially at this time, my dear brothers, because there is a lot of confusion. And some people, they are, you know, they come without understanding the word that they say and label people that they are not a Muslim. طيب. But fasiq. Fasiq is not kafir. Fasiq is the one who commit major sin. But he's not out of tawheed, sinner, because his sin. They attribute faith to him. That means he's still what? A believer. But it was not the perfect faith that is rightful attribute of those who do acts of obedience and refrain from committing sin. His faith is impaired because of his wrong and because of his sin that he was committing. This matter, my dear brother, especially these days, should be very, very important to understand. Because the Muslim, as long as he believes in the oneness of Allah Azza wa Jal, as a human being, he is weak. Sometimes may commit some sins, even major sins. And why, if you notice in the names of Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah Azza wa Jal, his name Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. His name what? Al-Ghafur, Al-Ghaffar, At-Tawwab. Look how many names all go around what? Around mercy, repentance, and forgiveness. That even in one hadith, I'm not sure about the ethnicity of the hadith, but it's a very famous hadith, that if you were not committing sin as people, Allah may take you away and bring other people who commit sin, and then they seek forgiveness, and then Allah will forgive them. That doesn't mean here to encourage people to commit sin. Be careful. But to show you that committing sins is one of the weakness of man. And this is the story that was in the Quran when Adam committed the sin, and he's a prophet. And he was created by the hand of Allah Azza wa Jal. What the purpose, what the hikmah from repeating this story in the Quran several times? To tell us, to remind us as children of Adam, that you are weak and you may commit sins. So this is our nature. But the important thing for the Muslim, the believer, that he, whenever he commits sin or make mistake, what should he do? He should return and repent and ask Allah Azza wa Jalla forgiveness. The important thing that he should not continue. Because if the person continues sinning, and he thinks that, well, Allah forgive her. But sin after sin after sin, this may seal the heart. And when the heart is sealed, this may lead him to what? To commit shirk and commit kufr. So committing sins, you know, this is a weakness of man. But to insist and continue committing sin without repentance, if the person did not give up, its name will lead to what? To seal in the heart. قال عز وجل كلا بل ران على قلوبهم ما كانوا يكسبون. Look at this ayah. Allah عز وجل talk about those disbelievers and explain why. كلا بل ران على قلوبهم. On their hearts, the ran. Ran is the sins. And this ayah was explained by the hadith of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام when he said, when a man commits a sin, إذا أذنب العبد نكتت في قلبي نكتة سوداء. When a man commits a sin, then one dot will be marked in his heart. Black dot. If he repented, it will be what? Clear and erased. If he continued did another sin, what will happen? Another dot. Just imagine when dot after dot after dot, what will happen? It will be black, خلاص. There's no way. Subhanallah. So the important thing for every man or every person, man or woman, that whenever he commits sin, he should what? Repent and return to Allah Azza wa Jal and never continue. طيب. Now look at the Khawarij who denounce people as kafir because of their sins. Who are the Khawarij? The Khawarij, those are a group of rebels. They come out at the time of Ali radiallahu anhu, at the time of the Khilafah of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, the fourth of the fourth guided Khalifa, Khalifa al-Rashid. There was tried to settle the dispute between Ali and Muawiyah, رضوان الله عليه. So Ali radiallahu anhu accepted to make some negotiation with them. These people, they, you know, come out from the side who they are supporter to Ali radiallahu anhu. They come out and they said, how come you, oh you Ali, you follow the desire of the people, you listen to them. That means you accept, you know, for the treaty that one representative from your side, who was Abu Dhar, and one from the side of Muawiyah, who was Amr ibn al-As, and you accept what they decide. So you choose, look to their understanding, you choose the law of man over the law of Allah, the Quran. And this in fact is shubha. What does it mean, shubha? Huh? This is something which is not clear, doubts. So this group, and they started to say, anyone, you know, by the time passing, it was at the beginning was political movement, but then by the time passing become as a group of with different sect, aqeedah, نعم, not madhab, aqeedah, khawarij. So Ali radiallahu anhu sent Abdullah ibn Abbas to what? To discuss with them and negotiate with them. And he answered all their doubts. So around, they said 2,000 to 3,000 of them, they retained. And they repented. But a group of them, they continue. SubhanAllah, it is the wisdom of Allah Azza wa Jal. SubhanAllah. Fitna. So those continue by the time, and they, you know, their aqeedah was developed by that time. So one of the major thing in their aqeedah, that committing major sin make the person disbeliever. This is called khawarij. Why they call them khawarij? Because they get out, kharaju ala Ali radiallahu anhu. But this is their aqeedah. Right. Let's see what they say. طيب. In contrast of these, that means these whom? The Salaf, the Ummah. You know, the opposite side, you will find the Khawarij. There was another group who accused Muslim people of kufr if they fell short in any obligatory duty or if they committed any haram action. So whenever anybody commit anything, they said this is, you know, then this is kafir. And this is what these people nowadays, you may say, subhanAllah, surprise, how come a man who say that he's a Muslim, he will go inside a masjid, and blow himself and kill many of the believers who are praying. What type of religion is this? See, because they believe that all these are committing sin, therefore they are لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. نسأل الله السلامة. طيب. So we still see many people hastening to condemn people as kafir in similar manner. You know, some people, they just, you know, if there's anybody committed sin, they said, yeah, he's a kafir. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. And this is why we should be very careful not to label anyone who believe in Allah Azza wa Jal as disbelief. And inshallah, if you go back to the shurut la ilaha illallah, conditions of la ilaha illallah, you understand, because la ilaha illallah has certain conditions. The first group adopt this approach was the Khawarij, a group who emerged from the army of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. After the appointing arbiter Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, sorry, I said Abu Dhar, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari and Amr ibn al-As. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari is a Sahabi, رضوان الله عليه, and Amr ibn al-As. Amr ibn al-As represent Muawiyah in the, you know, the, try to settle the dispute. And Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, رضي الله عنه, he was representing the side of Ali ibn Abi Talib, رضي الله عنه. had failed to end the dispute that was raging among the Muslim under the leadership of Ali and Muawiyah. And here, my dear brothers, I want you to just very, very quick advice. We should not keep ourselves busy about what happened between Muawiyah and Ali. What happened at the time of the Sahaba, this is fitna. This is fitna. But some people, they may try to dig in this fitna and they say, yeah, this, look, this is Sahaba. They did this and they did that. This is something is already gone. And Allah Azza wa Jal will judge among them. And this is why one of the Salaf, he was asked by some people, they said, what do you think about what happened between Muawiyah and Ali? He said, that's fitna that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made us far away from ish, from be with them with our sword at that time. Therefore, alhamdulillah, we should be away from with our tongue. So we should not talk or discuss about it. تِلْكَ أُمَّةٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ. This is a generation that passed away and went, خلاص. Allah Azza will not ask you, what do you think about what happened between Ma'awi or Ali? But the enemies of Islam, they always, they dig and try to find any roots or seeds for the differences between the Muslim. And they try to make, you know, big story of that and try to make, divide the Muslim. طيب. The Khawarij claim that appointing men as arbitrators was a mistake according to the Sharia and they regarded it as kufr. Rahmatullah. As kufr. That means they are accusing whom? Accuser Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu of kufr, subhanallah. And the Sahaba who are with him. Why? Because how come you accept men to make this judgment among you? Yani subhanallah, Abdullah ibn al-Abbas, he answered them for this. He said, you don't read the Quran. It was mentioned in the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal, in the Quran, in certain situation, Allah said, let two just people of you, among you, believer, to make judgment. That means this was already where? In the Quran. So it's okay to go back, you know, for this, as long as there is no exact, clear, you know, statement in the Quran about this matter. Wal urf, you know what does it mean, urf? Huh? Yeah, the tradition of the community, consider one of the source. That means the Sharia depend on sometimes. Like, for example, in nafaqa. Al nafaqa, you know what does it mean, nafaqa? Spending. The spending, how come we decide how much you give the wife? They said, no, here we go to what? To the direction of the community. This woman in this social class, how much usually is her spending or given? And there are many different situations which we take, you know, we refer to the tradition of the community. And this tradition are different from one place to another. Right? So their argument was baseless. But to show you what they do, they take the ayat or the word verbally, just, you know, verbal, without understanding the meaning behind this word. And this is why always we say, it's not for anyone to take just one verse of the Quran or take one hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And then he go and try to make conclusion, type, or try to derive any rule by his own. He should go back to whom? To the ulama, the scholars, the ulama. Why? Because the ulama, they verify different evidences. And then they come from the conclusion from after reading, you know, and searching all these evidences from the Quran and the Sunnah.
So they viewed as kufr all Muslim who had agreed to that. Subhanallah. That means they are the only one who are Muslim and the rest of the ummah are kafir. So this they label whom? The Sahaba or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And testify that they themselves turned to be disbelievers because they had initially agreed to arbitrate. They then entered the pale of Islam afresh. They said, even we themselves, even we were, but now we return back to Islam. They demand that Ali should also accept that he committed kufr by agreeing to that, and then he should pronounce shahada. Now this means come back again to Islam. As condition for the returning to the rank of his army. Ali radiallahu an disputed with them and sent to them the great scholar of this ummah, Ibn Abbas, who established proof against them and refuted their point of view. A few thousand of them came back, as we said, which is about between 2,000 to 3,000. They returned to the fold of the army, طيب, and to Islam. But 2,000 persisted in following their opinion and fought. Ali, who defeated them and finished them off. So at the time of Ali radiallahu an, the Khawarij was where? Huh? They were ended. But the seed is still there. The seed and the roots still there. And always the hypocrite and the munafiqeen and those the enemies of Islam, what they do? Huh? They go and search for these roots and try to revive it again. This is why, my dear brothers, may notice the enemies of Islam, what they do? They do comprehensive study for every Muslim community. They go to every Muslim community and they collect very detailed information about races, about sects, about madahib, about traditions, about even tribes. So they use this to make what? Dispute among the Muslims. And this is what we notice right now. You see, in every Muslim community now, you find there some dispute, either based on races. For many years, we didn't hear always what we know, Afghanistan and Afghani, right or not? Nowadays, what you hear? Among Afghani, there is Tajik, there is Pashto, there. Who brought all these races? Huh? See? So divided the community. Like in Iraq, they said. Arab, Kurd, Turkoman, all these. For 1,000 years, they were living together as what? As Iraqi Muslim. But this is the way of the enemies of Islam throughout history. This is why the Muslim should be aware and should not listen to all these call, labeling people, either by religion. This is why Allah Azza wa Jalla said, Naam, inna akramakum inda Allahi atqaakum. Khalas. The Muslim should be united on one stand. What is it? Islam. Islam united the ummah throughout history. Have you ever read in literature of Islam or Islamic books, they say black Muslim and white Muslim? Have you ever heard this? طيب, nowadays you see this in some countries or not? Huh? Isaac Jatani. Is it true or not?
Yes.
Huh? They said black American, white American, Hispanic. This is not known in the Muslim community, in a Muslim civilization. Because throughout history, they're Muslim. They are from different races, subhanallah, from different cultural background. But we never hear they were, throughout Islamic history, they were classified to groups, Muslim, and that's it. And then depending on what? On their
righteousness, their deeds, their achievement. And this is why all Muslims at the time of this, you know, in the past, in the Islamic civilization, compete according to their effort. This is why we find Al-Bukhari, all Muslims refer to the book of Al-Bukhari, right or not? But is Al-Bukhari Arab? He's not Arab. We never heard about this. So, the Muslim and Muslim Ummah should be united under one umbrella. What is it? Islam. Islam. And that's it. And we should not, in our community, in everywhere, we should not classify people or try to divide them or align or divide it to parties. And the Quran is many, many, subhanAllah, ayat which emphasize the importance of the unity of the Ummah. That even sometimes you give up some duties for the purpose of what? Of the unity of the Ummah. The unity of the Ummah of Islam. They should be united. طيب. The evidence quoted by the Khawarij for denouncing as kafir those who commit major sin. Tell me when the time is. Why that we bring this, my dear brothers? We need to study these evidences. Why? Because these evidences are now used also by some of the current day's Khawarij. So when you know how to respond to it, it's very important to understand this so you can explain to the people around you that they have no knowledge about this. But what they are claim? The evidence quote by the Khawarij for denouncing as kafir those who commit major sin. The Khawarij claim that the one who commits a major sin is a kafir and is no longer Muslim, and his blood and wealth are lawful for them. Because if he is not Muslim, فَقَدْ أَهْدَرُوا دَمَهُ وَمَالَهُ. Ahdaru, that means they said he's not. And this is طيب. So he may be killed and his wealth seized by them, or by the way they call Muslim. They say that he will abide in the hell forever. They quote in support for their view evidence which they thought proved their case, such as the following. Look to the, when you know some people they quote from the Quran, you know, certain verses, and they explain it their own way, their own understanding. They said, you agree with that, with us, this is their argument. They said, you agree with us that deeds are part of the faith, because Iman is composed of belief, words, and deeds. No question about this. نعم الإيمان قول واعتقاد وعمل صح ولا لا طيب قول by statement by saying لا إله إلا الله شأن لا إله إلا الله شأن رسول الله نعم واعتقاد believe in the heart وعمل deeds they said you say that the إيمان composed of these three things طيب so if one part of faith such as action is missing then the whole of Iman is absent. Look to their conclusion. So deeds, if one of the deeds is not correct, that means the rest is
invalid.
Subhanallah. طيب. They quoted as evidence the fact that Allah Azza wa Jalla described some sins as fisq. In the ayah, إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَعٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. نعم. This ayah in Surah Al-Hujurat. If a fasiq, a liar or evil person comes to you with any news, then verify it. The word fasiq here is applied to a liar, which is quite obvious to anyone who looks at the context of the ayah. But this is one of their claims. Now the Sheikh is
presenting their claims and then he will respond. طيب. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, for a believer to trade insult with another is fasiq. For a believer to trade insults with another is fusuq. سباب المسلم ها وسباب المؤمن نعم فسوق. And they said that Allah called some sins such as consuming orphan wealth ظلم ظلم. إن الذين يأكلون أموال اليتامى ظلما إنما يأكلون في بطونهم نارا. Barely those who unjustly eat up the property of orphans, they eat up only fire into their bellies. Look how they choose the word. You know, they take it from its context, in the general context of the Sharia. And he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, he calls the one who evict a widow from her marital home during the time of her iddah, that's when who, the one who and leave his wife to as zulm, because transgressing the limit set by Allah Azza wa Jal. واتقوا الله لا تخرجونها إلى آخر الآية. طيب. They say these sins are fisq and zulm. Fisq وظلم. So they choose these two terms, and from these terms now they try to conclude. It's like mathematical services. So they said these sins are fisq and zulm, and the fasiqun and zalimun are kafir, as the Quran said. Look at what they said. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla said, "Wal kafiruna hum al-zalimun." It's true. The kafir, and it is the disbelievers who are wrongdoers. It is true or not? The kafir, is he wrongdoer or right doer? So, but what they did, they said, Allah said, Al-Kafiruna hum al-Zalimun. And another ayah, he described the one who takes the money of the orphan as Zalim. You get the point? So, he is Zalim, and Allah said here about the Kafir is Zalim, therefore they are Kafir. This is the way they play with the ayat of Allah Azza wa Jal, the Quran. قال عز وجل ومن كفر بعد ذلك فأولئك هم الفاسقون. Another ayah. But whoever disbelieved after this, they are the fasiqun, rebellious. So the same نعم thing they did it here. And they said the text indicate that those who commit sins are not believers. For example, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم reported narrated by Muslim would say, the one who commit zina is not a believer at the time when he is committing zina. لا يزني ها الزاني حين يزني وهو مؤمن. And the one who steal is not a believer at the time when he is stealing. ولا يسرق السارق حين يسرق وهو مؤمن. And the one who drinks wine is not a believer at the time when he is drinking. ولا يشرب الخمر شاربها حين يشربها وهو مؤمن. And Allah said, and he صلى الله عليه وسلم said, no one who believes in Allah and his messenger can hate the Ansar. And they said, by the one in whose hands in my soul, you will not enter paradise. Look to this hadith. Until you believe, and you will not believe until you love one another. So they quote all these quotes, and they say, he say not believe, he say disbeliever. Yes, and we know sometimes, my dear brothers, sometimes when the word come, la yu'minu ahadukum, that doesn't mean the whole iman. So like when he said, la yu'minu ahadukum hatta yuhibbu li akhi ma yuhibbu li nafsi. None of you should be believer till he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. The ulama said the meaning here, that means he doesn't have what the perfect believe. But here they said, I see, he doesn't believe,
So they take away all his deeds and they label him as disbeliever just because of this. So this is to show you that they are confused. They just take words and they put their argument based on this word. Why? So just finish this point. They say the messenger disowned those who committed certain sins, such as when he said, whoever bears arms against us is not one of us. من حمل السلاح علينا فليس منا. And whoever deceived us is not one of us. ومن غشنا ليس منا. The one who cheated us is not one of us. So they say, you see, the Prophet said, he is not one of us. That means he is what? He is not Muslim. Listen. But here doesn't mean this. But they put it there on way. Anyway, we'll stop here, inshallah, we'll continue. So in conclusion, what we say, these people, they just take the ayat, twisted the meaning in their own way without looking and all the evidences or the ayat or the understand the saying in the whole meaning, and then they label people of disbelief. May Allah Azza wa Jalla protect us from this. This is why, my dear brothers, we should be aware of this, especially at this time, because there is fitna. And we should, watch for our kids, our children. Because, the children, especially the youth, they are highly motivated, and they feel the pain when they see Muslims, suffering. And those criminals, these terrorist groups, what they do, they take advantage of the sympathy of those youth, and they try to invest it to serve their own interest. So we should be aware, we should teach our kids, the right aqidah and protect them from this disease. May Allah Azza wa Jal protect us all. Okay, we'll stop here and we'll go to the fiqh class. Where what's that last point that we reach? Did we start Maymun or not yet? No. So we reached the hadith of Maymun, Ibn Abbas,
Ibn Abbas.
Page 20. طيب وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما مضبوط ها نعم this is a hadith number
7
in the book
10
the book 10 طيب وعن you know the different why. Because sometimes they count the same hadith with different narration as what? Independent hadith. So this is now we see the difference between, like wa'anhu, for example, wa'anhu, wa fi riwayat li Muslim, say that it's considered as different hadith. And here in the book, Sheikh al-Sharh bin Uthaymeen, he considered it as part of the first hadith. So this is why you see this difference in number. Anyway, and the book 2, which is number 10 here, وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما. Be careful to what I'm saying. رضي الله عنهما. Not رضي الله عنه only. Be careful. We'll talk about this. أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم
كان يغتسل بفضل ميمونة رضي الله عنها، أخرجه مسلم. نريتد ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما، the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم used to wash with the water left over by ميمونة رضي الله عنها. This hadith reported by Muslim. طيب first of all, why did we say رضي الله عنهما؟ That means may Allah be pleased with both of them. Whom, who are they? ابن عباس. That means ابن عباس, عبد الله and his father العباس رضي الله عنه. Because both are صحابي. Same like when you talk about عن عبد الله ابن عمر, you say رضي الله عنهما. نعم. عن عائشة بنت أبي بكر رضي الله عنهما. Always when you mention if the father and the son are صحابي, said عنهما both. عنهما that's mean, you know. طيب let's first of all take up ابن عباس. We all know that ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما is the scholar of this ummah. حبر هذه الأمة, the great scholar of this ummah. And also some of his title is ترجمان القرآن. ترجمان from ترجم, which means explain, the explainer of the Quran. Even he was at the time the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was what?
Kid.
He was a kid. You remember the hadith, يا غلام, it was for ابن عباس رضي الله عنه. طيب فولد رضي الله عنهما ورضى عبد الله رضي الله عنه قبل الهجرة بثلاث سنين. Before the hijra, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام 3 years. That means at the time of the hijra he was 3 years old. طيب so when he moved to the Medina, and if we say that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم stayed in Medina around 10 years, that means when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم passed away he was only 13 years old. Yeah, maybe around this. Anyway, وتوفي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو ابن 13 وقيل 15. There's some narration that said he was 15 years old. كان وسيما جميلا مدين القامة مهيبا. He was very good looking, you know, because he's the cousin of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he's from the tribe, the same tribe. دعا له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال اللهم فقهه في الدين وعلمه التأويل. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام made dua for him, special dua for Abdullah ibn Abbas. اللهم فقهه في الدين. And you remember we talk about the meaning of fiqh, means give him understanding. الفقه معناه الفهم. الفقه معناه الفهم. طيب طيب. وعلمه التأويل. وقد صاحب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نحو 30 شهرا. And he reported many hadith the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. And he was very, mashallah, very knowledgeable person. Even he was young, that he has some knowledge that even some of the Sahaba, they didn't get. And this is because of the blessing of the dua of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. كان من ترجمان القرآن وحبر الأمة ومفسر الكتاب. These are three, you know, labels that for Abdullah ibn Abbas. ترجمان القرآن, explainer, the one who explained the Quran. حبر هذه الأمة. الحبر means the scholar, right? And this mentioned on the Quran, أحبارهم. نعم, أحبارهم is the scholars. أمه أم الفضل لبابة بنت الحارث الهلالية أخت ميمونة بنت الحارث. So now the hadith about whom? About ميمونة. طيب. And this is very private matter. You notice or not? ابن عباس is telling us that النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم used the water was left over, you know, from ميمونة in his washing. How come he know this? Which is, this is something what? Private matters or not? Because ميمونة is his aunt, خالة, the sister of his mother. طيب طيب how come Maymuna is telling him this? Isn't this something that you know? And he's still a kid. How come Maymuna is telling him this? To show you the fiqh, understanding of the Sahaba رضوان الله عليه. Because she knew that he will tell him so, because he noticed, she noticed that he is, mashallah, acquired knowledge, and the Ummah will benefit from his knowledge. So she passed this piece of information to him, so he can what? Transmit it to us, to the rest of the Ummah. And this to show you that when the matter is related to the religion, we should not say or shy about this, shying to talk or to explain if it's a matter of knowledge, of ilm. So she was not shy and said, the Prophet ﷺ, he was, you know, washing of whatever I left. And washing what? Janaba, ghusl, yaghtasil. So this to show you here. طيب. وهو والد الخلفاء العباسيين. He is the father of the Khulafa, the rulers of the Abbasi state. الدولة العباسية, in the period of Abbasiyin, which come after Amawiyin, you know, they come from his offspring. This is why they call it الدولة العباسية. Refers to Al-Abbas, his father. So they call الدولة العباسية أو خلفاء بني العباس. طيب. وهو أحد إخوة عشر ذكور للعباس من أم الفضل. He has 10 brothers and he was the youngest one. نعم.
His original name. What is his name?
Abdullah. His name is Abdullah.
Abdullah
ibn Abbas. نعم. He one of the Abadila. لما ويتوقع بات العبادلة. Yeah, he was, his name is Abdullah. طيب. روى الإمام أحمد في مسنده, there's hadith which is reported by الإمام أحمد saying عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وضع يده على كتفي أو على منكبي. This الراوي is reporting that Abdullah ibn Abbas said that the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام one time he put his hand على كتفي. الكتف هذا كتف شولد منكبي. شك سعيد, سعيد is the راوي, is it منكبي or طيب. ثم قال, and then he said, اللهم فقهه في الدين وعلمه التأويل. This is the دعاء that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم made for him, and you see how much it benefited. Look at this story which we need to learn from, especially for you, because you are seeking knowledge here, and think about it. قال ابن عباس رضي الله عنه لما قبض رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم passed away, قلت لرجل من الأنصار, I said to a man of the Ansar, they are kids, he was maybe 13-14, so one of his peer, you know, they were playing, he told him this, هلما فلنسأل رسول أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فإنهم اليوم كثير. He told them, let's go and sit with the Sahaba of the Prophet ﷺ. Now this day, they are very many around us. But what will happen? By the time passing, they will decrease. They gone. This is the subhanAllah, the way of life. And we are still young. And let's catch them, let's sit, let's learn from them. فقال يا عجبا لك يا ابن العباس. Look to the mentality of the other person. SubhanAllah, he didn't understand the wisdom of Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abbas said, nowadays we have the Sahaba, all of them around us. Let's learn, get knowledge from them. One day we may not find any to take knowledge. So what he said, what a strange thing, you know, think about you, Ibn Abbas. Do you think people, they are, will be in need for you and the Sahaba around them? You got the point? He said, people are not in need for you, Ibn Abbas. You are still kid. The Sahaba is around them. He didn't think about what? But the future. So, okay, when these Sahaba will go, who will carry their knowledge? قال فترك ذلك. So he didn't go with me. So Ibn Abbas, he wanted to encourage him. Let's go sit with the Sahaba, seek knowledge. But he didn't. So he left him. This is the point that I want to emphasize here. So for you, for anyone of seeker of knowledge, don't look to the people who may frustrate you. They are telling you, what need you are studying, you are right. Now, some people are saying this now. You are not in need to study. Any question, you just go to the internet, a click and you will find the answer. No need for teachers, no need for books, no need for classes. Don't you hear this sometimes?
Yeah. YouTube classes are there.
Subhanallah. Subhanallah. For how long? We don't know this technology will last for how long. Right? So if everyone, if the ummah, he depend on this technology, and then all of a sudden this technology gone, and people look around and there's no people who know the religion, who will teach the people and carry the message? This is why, dear brothers, you see, when you walk from your home, I know that some of you, jazakumullah khair, you are very tired because you have been working for the whole day. But you have determination to struggle for this, and you walk to learn this by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal, will have blessing in your life. And you will benefit others also. And this is a type of jihad, struggling for the sake of Allah. We'll stop for the adhan and then we'll continue. صلى على محمد وعلى محمد كما صليت على ابراهيم وبارك على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى ابراهيم. طيب, look what he said. So he left, he didn't care that, and his friend, and واقبلت وانا اسال اصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. But I took myself and go around asking the companion of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. That even sometimes I heard that one of the Sahaba, he has a hadith. Nobody knows this hadith except him. They tell me this. So and so, he has a hadith. So, قَالَ فَآتِي بَابَهُ وَهُوَ قَائِلْ. I come to his door, outside his door. وَهُوَ قَائِلْ, that means قَيْلُولَ, that means he's taking nap during the mid of the day. You know, when the sun hot, they call it qaylula. People relax. وَهُوَ قَائِلْ, look, at noon. فَأَتَوَسَّدُ رِدَاءِ, I take my clothes, or whatever he has, and he put it, and he, you know, sleep. Take a nap, on the where? On the door, waiting for what? For this man to come out just to ask him. Look how much he suffered, you know, just to learn one hadith. فيخرج فيراني. So when he come out, he will be shocked. He قل يا ابن عم رسول الله. Oh, you are the cousin of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. What's happened? Why you are here? ما جاء بك؟ قال نعم. هل أرسلت لي فأتيك؟ What's happened? Why did you come? Why didn't somebody to me? I'll come to you. You are the cousin of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فقل لا أنا أحق أن آتيك. No, it is my duty to come to you. Why? This is the cousin of the Prophet. And this is Sahabi. نعم. But why? Look to the fiqh of Ibn Abbas. No, it is my duty to come to you. Why? Because of what? What you have? You have knowledge. العلم يؤتى ولا يأتي. العلم, knowledge, you have to go. نعم, and walk for it. Struggle to get it. Don't wait and sit and wait for the علم, for the knowledge to come to you. طيب. قال فأسأله عن حديث. Then I will ask him about the hadith. قال فعاش هذا الرجل الأنصاري حتى رآني. So that friend, they talk about the son when he was a kid. فرآني, he saw me. And people around me, when they grow up, many of the Sahaba, they gone. And people, they come, the halaqa, and they ask him, Ibn Abbas, فرآني. And he noticed that people, everyone asking me, they قول, هذا الفتى كان أعقل مني. This boy or this man has more wisdom than me. Because you remember what he told him before. طيب. So he traveled with his father قبل الفتح. And they met the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم بالجحفة. When he was, you know, at the time he immigrated with his father while the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is going where? For the conquer of Mecca. نعم. And then فشاهد الفتح وحنين والطائف. So that's mean Abdullah ibn Abbas did, رضي الله عنهما, did not attend Badr or Uhud or many of these maghazis the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. طيب. So only he went to the Medina and it was يعني the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم only two or three years left. And he got all this knowledge. This is why he went around and asking the Sahaba. روى البخاري في صحيح عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنه كان عمر يدخلني مع أشياخ بدر. عمر رضي الله عنه when he was a خليفة, he had like what we called مشورة, you know, like برلمان or consultants counseling group around him, شورة of أشياخ بدر. أشياخ بدر, that's mean the elderly, صحابة who attend بدر. فكان عمر رضي الله عنه, he bring عبد الله بن عباس, he was only 15 or 16 years, and he get him with them. So some of them, they said, how come, ya عمر, you bring this kid with us? We have also kids, you know? So how come, يعني, you give this opportunity for him and not only kids. So Umar رضي الله عنه want to teach them, to tell them why. فقال عمر إنه من قال علمتم. You know this. You know who is he. فدعاه ذات يوم فدخله معهم. So one day they were getting together, so he called Ibn Abbas. And then he said, ما تقولون في قول الله تعالى إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح. Now Umar رضي الله عنه, he asking whom? الصحابة, elderly people. What do you say about إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح? You know the ayah? سورة النصر. طيب. That's mean, what does it mean? إذا جاء نصر الله, when the victory of Allah come and the conqueror come, this is what you can see it here. فقال بعضهم أمرنا أن نحمد الله ونستغفره إن نصرنا الله. Allah said that seek forgiveness and ask Allah forgiveness because he gave you victory.
This is the ayat. So he look at Ibn Abbas. طيب. Some of them they keep silent. So أكذلك تقول يا ابن عباس, is this what you say also? فقال لا. Ibn Abbas said no. قال so what do you say? هو أجل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. This verse was signed to the Prophet عليه السلام that he completes his mission. نعم. And it is time to, for him to depart from this world. When victory comes. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla said, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ. Praise Allah. وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. So they said, Allah Azza wa Jalla is informing his Prophet that when you see the deen established and people come, that means you finish your mission, your duty, and now it is time for to look for yourself and to ask forgiveness to praise Allah Azza wa Jalla. So Abdullah رضي ibn Abbas رضي الله عنه said, this is the ajal announcement of what? Of the death of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. فقال عمر ما أعلم منها إلا ما تقول. So Umar said, this is what I believe also. That means there is, they don't know. And Abdullah ibn Abbas, he knows this. And he did this, what for? To show them about the wisdom of this Sahabi. So this, you know, just very, very short about Abdullah ibn Abbas. Let's go back to the hadith. Anybody read the hadith? We already read the hadith or not yet?
Half of it.
Huh? Half
of it.
طيب. قال ولأصحاب السنن. نعم. وعن ابن عباس أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يغتسل بعد الميمونة. Narrated ابن عباس. I think we finished this. طيب. Let's go now to the شرح because we talk about. قال المصنف رحمة الله عليه الله أكبر هذا ضد ما اختاره العلماء الذين أشرنا لقولهم. شيخ بن عثيمين said, you see, this is in fact the view that we choose, you know, which contradict with what other scholars said, because there are some scholars who choose other view that it's not allowed for a man to use what was left from the woman to make ghusl. So this is the point here that the Sheikh is trying to explain. This referred to one said, لا تغتسل المرأة بفضل الرجل. This is one of narrations. لا تغتسل المرأة بفضل الرجل. Women should not use what was left by man for ghusl. بناء على الحديث الذي رواه الصحابي المجهول, which remember before. ولا يغتسل الرجل بفضل المرأة. This is another. This is a narration that said, women should not use what was left over from the water which the man used in his ghusl to make ghusl. And the same thing also for the man. He should not use water which was left by a woman. So this hadith contradicts with what? With that. And this is what the Sheikh is emphasizing. طيب. The Sheikh said, فَكَانَ الْأَوْلَى إِذَا أَرَدْنَا نُفَرِّقَ الْحَدِيثَ نُقُلْ لَا تَغْتَسِلْ الْمَرْأَةُ فَضْلَ الرَّجُلِ. So الراجح, that means the sound view according to this hadith, that it is okay. It is okay that if there's a water was left by the wife, then the husband can use it for ghusl. And the same. Here there are many, the Sheikh refers to many different fawaid, many different fawaid benefits that we learn from the hadith. First of all, he said, referring to the number of the wife, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he mentioned one of Ummat al-Mu'minin, which Maymuna bint al-Harith. And we know that the Prophet عليه السلام, he has many wives. But here the Sheikh, he wants to teach us a lesson And he said, ask this question. So why did the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has all these wives? Is it just because of pleasure? This is what some people may think. And this is what the enemies of Islam, they accuse the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam of this. They said, this man is love woman. This is why he has many wives. They don't know the wisdom behind this. And just think about it. If the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, when he married more than one woman because of pleasure, do you think he will go and choose this widow or divorced woman? Or he will go and get virgins, girls? The logic that, you know, the one who have pleasure, like pleasure, he will run after what? After young, virgin girls. The only virgin of all his wife, Aisha radiallahu anha. The rest are either divorced or widows. Right. So what the Sheikh here mentioned, some of the wisdom. One, he said, the Prophet alayhi salam, when he have with these women, it's like a team of students from the woman's side. So they record and learn from him, so they transmit whatever they learn to the ummah, because they will give detail that men cannot see, right or not. And his sahaba, even Abu Bakr, he's with him all the time. But private life, who will know it? No one except wife. So he have, and most, and all his wives, they were very intelligent women. They are noble women. Many of them of their, you know, among the chief of their tribes. You know, and they have weight and power in their community. And this is why even some of them, you know, they from their family from the Jew, they were. Like Safiya bint Huyay ibn Akhtar. Safiya radiallahu anha, her father, Huyay ibn Akhtar, he is the chief of his tribe. Subhanallah. So when she, the Prophet ﷺ married her after they conquered, you know, they were under his control, but he didn't treat her, he didn't treat her as what? As a slave. But he freed her and he married her. What happened? Her father and many of her tribes, they become to Islam. This is why they said, you know, no woman, this is what their statement, they said, no woman have blessed open her tribes like Safiya. Subhanallah. Naam? Juwayr ibn Harith? Naam, Juwayr. I mix between the two. Jazakallah khair. So there are two ladies, Juwayr ibn Harith also from...
Safiya is a Jew, Juwayriya is from Bani Mustalaq.
Bani Mustalaq. So those are two women, they and others, ladies that the Prophet ﷺ married, in fact, all of them, they have blessing over their tribes and their people. So this is one thing, to unite the Muslims. So all tribes, they know that they have like a representative or they have relation with the leadership. Other thing, as we said, the knowledge that will go around in this. Jazakallah khair to Kuratum, brother. Barakallah bik. Tayyib. من فوائد الحديث الإفضاء بما يستحيى منه عادة من أجل نشر العلم. That means it is okay, طيب, to talk and disclose something which is private or people may shy off for the purpose of what? Of knowledge. Purpose of teaching people. Because my dear brothers in Islam, we said, and this statement said, لا حياء في الدين. Some people, they misunderstand this. No shyness in the religion. Some people, they understand it in a different way. They say, see, in Islam, there is no shyness. That's not correct. Shyness, in fact, one of the aspects of Islam. Right? But here means that to ask
to the woman, for example, or even the man, in a certain matter, maybe which is very private, sometimes he need advice. So it's okay to talk to the scholar and explain to him the situation, even if it's very private, just for the purpose of learning. طيب. 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 Also from here, we conclude with this. Look to the how the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was very humble. And he is a prophet of Allah, the chosen one. And even though he used the water which was left over of his wife and used it for cleaning and for ghusl. طيب, I think we finish this hadith. Inshallah, next hadith will be Ashab al-Sunan. Inshallah, we'll talk about it next. Jazakallah.